Hello and welcome to worship. We're so glad you're joining us today. Just as we say when we gather inside our meeting house at the Congregational Church of Brookfield, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Whether we're worshiping together or apart over these electronic connections, we pray that we are walking closely with Jesus in step with his way of love. As our congregation's vision statement says, we listen closely to what Jesus would teach us as we do our best to make Jesus our mentor, as we pray, share, and welcome in his name. In today's Zoom service, my communion meditation, The Burden of Freedom, explores some challenging teachings of Jesus in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 11. After that, we'll invite you to gather your own bread and juice from your home to join us in a celebration of communion, when we can enjoy another original song from our talented choir member, Nancy True Sugden. We also get to hear from Mike Anastas as he shares a brief call to share about his Greek immigrant parents' search for a new life of freedom in America after they fled Turkey and the Armenian genocide there. Following this adult service, we have a brief children's worship that also focuses on the gospel passage from Matthew for today. You're in for a real treat today as our own gifted teacher, Mr. Young, brings Captain America to life to share some thoughts about the passage and some of his superhero friends, including Jesus and the Incredible Hulk. We also have virtual coffee hour planned for today for just about 30 to 40 minutes beginning at 11 a.m. We'd invite people to log on using the Zoom link that you should have received in your weekly email. If you didn't get it, you can always get added to that list at office@uccb.org. Each virtual coffee hour has a theme question that we discuss in small groups using Zoom's breakout rooms. This week's question is, what was your first job and what life lesson or special thing did you learn from it? So we hope you'll come prepared to share your answer or just sit and listen and catch up with old friends or make new ones. We're also excited about our summer church school at home program, which will help families explore the ways we see God and God's gifts in nature. We also continue this week our live Zoom church school program with Mrs. Crandall. So if a young person in your family wants to know more or get included in that program, you can email us also at office@uccb.org. And now, people of faith, may the Holy Spirit draw our hearts together in silent prayer as we begin our worship reflecting on these inspirational words from the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., inviting us into Christ's way of peace.
Let us enter into our time of worship, hearing the ancient call of the psalmist to us today and centering our hearts in a time of silent prayer. People of faith, our Creator is great. Let every generation declare God's mighty acts. On the glory and majesty of God's wondrous works, let us meditate. Let us celebrate the abundant goodness of God's bountiful and steadfast love. We will give thanks to you, O God. We will bless you faithfully. Forever and ever.
Will you join me now in prayer? Let us pray. Good and gracious God, your Spirit is as near to us as breath and as gentle as a summer breeze. Thank you for refreshing us with the gift of your presence and your peace, for we confess that the angry struggles of this world often drag us down, and we stumble in walking your way of love. Thank you for lifting us up again and steering us back to the right path. You are our still speaking God, our holy parent. So help us to listen closely for your voice of wisdom. Remind us to bring our pain and need to you. Help us to trust that you are there to wipe away our tears and to give us exactly what we need. Help us to stay true to you through the grace and power of our Savior Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us pray. God of celebration and grief, God of fasting and feasting, God of love and justice, as your word is read, we pray that you reveal your wisdom and truth to us once again. For we confess we are prone to wander like toddlers in our own headstrong ways. Open us to receive your word and be fed by your hand, receiving the gift of your kingdom with humble openness and trust through the power and grace of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 11, verses 16 through 20 and 25 through 30. Jesus said to them, "But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, 'He has a demon.' The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, 'Look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners.' Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds." Then he began to reproach the cities in which most of his deeds of power had been done, because they did not repent. Then Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will rest, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." May God add a blessing to the reading of this holy word. Amen.
Will you pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our minds and hearts, as we worship you together today, may it all be acceptable and even pleasing to you, for you are our strength and our salvation. Amen. On this July 4th weekend, the word freedom rings in the air. As the Declaration of Independence proclaims, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We are so blessed to live in this sweet land of liberty. We celebrate our freedom and we give thanks to God for the men and women who won our freedom for us. Freedom isn't free, as our veterans will remind us. With freedom comes responsibility. Freedom has its boundaries. As Paul wrote in his first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 10, verses 23 and 24, "All things are lawful, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. Do not seek your own advantage, but that of the other." Or as my dad used to always say, "Your freedom ends where my nose begins." And never was that more true than in this age of COVID. One of our essential workers was telling me about trying to do their job in a grocery store and politely telling a customer that they were supposed to be wearing a mask and not carrying it. And in response, the customer just came closer, deliberately coughed right in their face, and then stormed off saying, "Hey, it's a free country." So I ask you, is that what freedom in Christ looks like? And what is a good Christian to do? Look the other way, turn the other cheek, or seek justice? See that our Christian prime directive to love one another gets followed, that maybe other more vulnerable customer gets protected. Because with freedom, we learn comes responsibility. That's the burden of freedom, and that's what Jesus addresses, I think, in this challenging passage from Matthew. My yoke is easy, he says, and my burden light. I don't know. I don't think it's that easy. Jesus, like all the great Hebrew prophets who came before him, would say that freedom granted to us by our Creator tells us that we aren't to live in the freedom of wild animals, running in a rat race with every man for himself. Instead, our scriptures call us to live in covenant with God and with one another as God's faithful flock. To claim our birthright as children of God, we're called to love our neighbor, to look to the common good of all. To live under God's rule means we agree to bear the yoke of Christ, sharing our life together as one human family in brotherhood and sisterhood. And it is not easy. It has never been easy. Even though freedom was a founding ideal of our country, we have to admit we have fallen far short of that goal. We stole the lives and land of Native Americans and Latinos. We tortured and killed African Americans under hundreds of years of slavery. Women only just got the vote 100 years ago, and voting rights across this nation are still being actively suppressed. The movement towards liberty and justice for all continues as tyrants still rise up to extinguish the flame of freedom. This is how the tides of history move in our country as in the ancient world. We keep marching on weary feet, as did generations who came before us, as John the Baptist, zealots, and other freedom fighters did in the time of Jesus, and as the Hebrew people did for generations before that. Then, as now, it's hard to know the right way to go. But as Jesus says in this passage, wisdom is justified by her deeds. In other words, how we behave is often more important than specifically what we say or teach. I think it's worth looking at this fiery sermon from Jesus again, because I think it still speaks to our time. It's really shocking to hear this much rage from Jesus, as in chapter 11 we see. The part the lectionary leaves out is great. Jesus has worked up a great head of steam. He was calling out specific cities that had rejected him. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! And you, Capernaum, will you be exalted in heaven? No, you will be brought down to Hades! Oh, self-righteous anger, it feels so good, doesn't it? It's so human of Jesus to defend himself so forcefully against his detractors. And that's exactly what he was doing. John the Baptist was already in prison, but this chapter begins with the story of how John sends his disciples specifically in to question Jesus, to figure out whether or not he really was the Messiah. And Jesus was just beside himself to be in the heat of such divisiveness in a time his country should have been pulling together. Isn't it easy to hear ourselves in this, or to at least hear the loud talking heads on the news or our meanest friends on Facebook? When we hear these ranting words of Jesus telling them to do better, to what will I compare this generation, says Jesus. You are like children, sitting around poking and taunting each other. Stop your name calling. You sound like kids in the schoolyard. Some of you are happy with your lives, so you complain that others are too negative about everything. You think people should lighten up. Others of you see trouble everywhere and complain that people aren't upset enough and grieving with you. That is just how it is in politics. You thought John the Baptist was too serious and judgmental, and that I am too happy and inclusive of people you don't like. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. Doesn't that sound like a sermon that could be directed at us today? We need to be more mindful of the results of the choices we make and the actions we take, as well as to stop our wailing and complaining always about the choices and actions of others. It's all too easy to get worked up about those people on the other side, whatever issue it is that divides us. But Jesus reminds us that God's way of covenant faithfulness calls us to join in a yoke of connection with all our brothers and sisters, to pull together in faith. This is the greatest priority of Jesus, whether you love your neighbor and accept the yoke that connects us all. Not whether you lean left or right politically, but whether you love your neighbor and accept the yoke that connects us all. Not whether you are black or white, Catholic or Protestant, or even Muslim or Jewish, Buddhist or Hindu, but whether you love your neighbor and accept the yoke that connects us all. Is that so hard? This ranting Jesus of Matthew asks us. What's wrong with you people? My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Well, that's what Jesus said, but surely not the way he said it. He says he is gentle and humble in heart, and I believe him. I think he knew instinctively what the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said in the quote that opened our worship service today, that peace should not only be the goal that we seek, but the means by which we achieve that goal. There was probably a very deep sigh there for Jesus as he changed gears at the end of his long, angry sermon, as he toned down his volume and used his peaceful inside voice instead. Take my yoke upon you, he said, and learn from me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So my Bible study group wondered what changed for Jesus in the middle of that rant, that long, angry sermon, what helped him stop defending himself and yelling at his enemies. We need to learn that lesson, I think. So here's what we noticed happened. He reined himself in. He redirected his words, his voice, his very deep pain. He directed his words not to his enemies, but to God instead. He started to pray and he called upon the Holy Spirit. He said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Like a small child at prayer, Jesus surrendered his will and his anger to God, and he showed us the way we should go. Is that so hard? You'd think that Christ's way of peace bearing his yoke of steadfast love would be easy. You'd think that burden would be light. Even infants have the wisdom to trust in the strong arms that hold them. What in God's name is wrong with us? We squirm away from God and God's love like headstrong toddlers. We fight on the playground for turf like rowdy children at recess. But with our brother Jesus, let us remember God's abundant mercy and forgiving love. Let us remember not to be so focused on the speck in our neighbor's eye and miss the log in our own. Let us remember our call to the communion table. At Christ's feast, we stop slinging the green peas at our brother and stealing the cookie off the plate of our sister. We don't behave like that at Christ's table. When we accept Christ's yoke, we obey and we sit calmly at his side. We step up from our noisy and messy kids' table of greedy self-interest. We become instead like the children in Martin Luther King's great I Have a Dream speech, and we sit down together at the table of brotherhood and sisterhood. We hold hands, or once when we could hold hands, we did. We pray for peace at God's grown-up table of grace. As we break bread and share the cup, we give thanks for this Holy Spirit that unites us, that binds us in covenant, in spite of our human brokenness and sin. As I close and as we prepare to hear a moving national tribute in song to Dr. King on the occasion of his birthday this past January, I want to share with you his words, because they speak of the yoke that binds us together as one people. He said this: "For many of our white brothers, as evidenced by their presence here today, have come to realize that their destiny is tied up with our destiny. And they have come to realize that their freedom is inextricably bound to our freedom. We cannot walk alone." This is good news, that our freedom in Christ calls us to work together in a yoke for the good of all of God's people. And the real burden of freedom is to willingly bear the burden of that yoke in Christ, to gladly relinquish our headstrong personal freedom, and to choose instead to move in humble and gentle obedience to Christ's will and way, to walk closely by his side wherever he calls us to go. People of faith, let us rejoice. We do not walk alone. Thanks be to God for this good news. Amen.
Steady, brave, and bold.
Friends, the service has been pre-recorded, but know that we want to hold your joys and concerns in our prayers. So please let us know if you have others that we should be praying for by reaching out via email to our church office or to myself or to Pastor Bryn. But today we invite you to hold these people in your prayers. We are praying for all of those who are grieving the loss of dear ones in their life, especially for Tyler and his family as they grieve the loss of his grandma, and for Brian and Jen as they grieve the loss of a very late-term pregnancy. We pray for those recovering from surgery, for Sydney, Beth, Roy, and Azat, and those recovering from other illnesses as well, like Craig, Monica, and Larry. We lift up prayers for John, newly diagnosed with Parkinson's, and for Bill, diagnosed with cancer, and for others like Valerie and Terry, suffering from chronic illnesses. We pray for Nick that his scans this week show good results. We continue our prayers for all those on the front lines working in healthcare or in essential industries during this COVID crisis and for all of our first responders. We also pray for those struggling with family conflicts, domestic violence, or addiction. We pray for help and healing for those struggling with mental health issues and for all children in foster care as well. And we pray with others in our community and around the world for all who are working for racial justice and for the men and women who honor their uniforms in public service. We also have a few joys to lift up today, and so we invite your prayers of joy and blessing for Tyler and Samantha, who were married on Friday, for Heather and Nick as they prepare for a new baby, and for Kendra and Dan as they welcomed baby Eliza into the world last Sunday. And now, friends, I invite you to join with me in the spirit of prayer. God, you call us to draw close to you, to lay our burdens down at your feet and to sit and rest a while. In this time, it seems that the burdens are many as we struggle to figure out how to work and play in new ways, how to stay healthy and keep others healthy, as we mourn and celebrate together but at a distance, as we try to listen intently to your call to be a part of the solution to this world's problems. We pray that you would help us to realize the blessing that we have and the gift of being yoked together in community, and the gift of your guidance and wisdom shared with us through the words and lived example of Jesus Christ. We pray that those whom we have lifted up for reason of concern might know the power of drawing near to you as well, and that in doing so they might find your peace, know your love, and experience your healing power in their lives in whatever way possible, whether physically, mentally, or in relationship building and reconciliation. We pray that you would grant us the wisdom to make space to hear the voices of those who are crying out for justice and those who don't believe or think exactly as we do. We pray the spirit to know when to speak and the courage to ask for real and deep listening when we have something we feel needs to be said, as we strive to do what we have been called to do through your holy word, to speak the truth in love. We realize that part of our life's journey and learning comes through struggle. So we ask that you would grant us the strength and patience to sit in the midst of struggle when it comes, the grace to forgive others when we have been hurt, even as you forgive us, the courage to ask for forgiveness when needed, and the initiative to move ourselves and our community closer to you and toward your kingdom where the burdens are few and the load is light, where the weary can find rest, and where we can celebrate together. God, we thank you for the celebrations that we have been able to lift up today, the new steps in relationships marked by the covenant of marriage, and the new life we celebrate with those expecting or who have brought new little ones into the world. God, in these things, we see such promise and hope, especially in a time when so much seems dim and bleak. Help us to hold on to the feeling of joy that we have when we see the miracle of new life and when we embark on new adventures. And on this Independence Day weekend, God, we are grateful for the joyful life of freedom we are offered in our country. Help us to realize that through that freedom comes responsibility. And our freedom in you comes with the responsibility of doing what is good and what is right, of caring for others, of sharing love, of working for justice, of following your will and your way, which will hopefully help to bring about true freedom for all of your beloved children. We pray this in the name of our example and guide, Jesus. Amen.
Hello, I'm Mike Anastas. My wife, Diana, and I have been members of the Congregational Church of Brookfield since about 2004. We're lucky to be members of a wonderful, loving congregation and led by a loving staff. I'm lucky to be an American because my Greek parents were born in Asia Minor. They were descendants of the earliest Christians there. They fled Muslim oppression in Turkey to go to Russia, where they lived happily. And then they fled the Bolsheviks in Russia to come here. One of the reasons I like being a Congregationalist is because American Congregationalists taught my father at Roberts College English, American, and the American way of life. And I'm grateful for that. I like supporting the work of our church here and around the world. And I want to thank you for supporting this wonderful Congregational Church of Brookfield.
In every generation of the faithful, Christ calls us to his table. We come not because we must, but because we may. We come at the invitation of the risen Christ, who is both our teacher and our gracious host. Although we are breaking bread now in our separate homes, it is the spirit of our Prince of Peace who calls us together and makes us one. We remember how Jesus, on the last night of his life, when he knew he was to be betrayed and deserted by one of his closest friends, we remember how he took bread, and after he had blessed it and given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you. Each time you eat of it, break it. Share it with each other and remember me."
And friends, we remember how in the same way after supper, Jesus took the cup and offering it to his disciples, he said, "Take this, all of you, and drink of it. This is the cup of the new and everlasting covenant shed for love of you. As often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." Will you pray with me? Holy One, we thank you for these humble gifts, the grain of the earth and the fruit of the vine, and we pray that you would send your spirit upon these elements and upon us. Consecrate these gifts and transform them by the power of your Holy Spirit into something so much more than mere bread and juice, into a feast of memory and meaning, into refreshment and renewal in mind, body, and spirit, into an opportunity to join together across the boundaries of time and place that separate us. And we are bold to pray that you would transform us too. Transform us into peacemakers, love bearers, blessing deliverers, even more into the likeness of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. And so now, friends, ministering to you in the name of Jesus Christ, we invite you to join us in sharing the bread of life and the cup of blessing.
Forgiveness and yearn for the Spirit inside as we break bread together.
Let us join now in a prayer of thanksgiving. Holy One, we thank you for blessing us with the outpouring of your life-giving mercy, for your amazing grace, and for all the good gifts you invite us to enjoy. We are ever grateful. May this holy meal nourish our souls, strengthen our faith, and unite us in our call to share your love with the world. Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with loving kindness and grant you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. So now, as we go forth into this week, may we work together for justice and peace, bearing in ourselves the image of Christ as we walk closely with him in love and faithfulness. People of faith, go in peace.